hosted a affordable housing summit at Town Hall meeting on October 14th, which is next Saturday from 10 a.m. to 3 p.m. at the Milford Hunter Center. So it will be a free event to provide services as well as information on affordable housing. There'll be over 20 agencies and organizations there present, as well as a number of city departments to help give people information, advice, and a path to help improve their housing situation. Fire prevention week starts October 8th, so it's October 8th through the 14th. Our fire department's doing a lot of things, station tours, puppet shows, school visits, planning to teach and reinforce the lessons of good fire protection. And this year's theme is Every Second Counts, Plan Two Ways Out. And also two upcoming volunteer events. We have the Rivers Alive on October 14th from 8:30 a.m. to 11:30 a.m. Eight volunteers will participate in that. Aaron Strickland and Keith Lounge, our most beautiful spirit as ever. And then the Make a Difference Day that we have every year is on October 28th from 8:30 a.m. to 1 p.m. Again, KLBB is leading those efforts. If anyone wanting to volunteer, can certainly reach out and contact Aaron Strickland. Two other things, Mayor. I want to just give a brief update on the yard debris. Since the storm, we heard folks tonight talking about it, and I think it's important to put some perspective on it. For the first time in the history of the state of Georgia, all 159 counties were declared a state of emergency. And it was an unprecedented storm, as you heard Georgia Power refer to. Never in our history, we've had about 80% of our residents without power. And we look all around us at what happened. As close as Brunswick, 2 hours away, no water, no services. I'm Jack Lyle, and they were without water for over a week. And widespread damage, north, south, east, west, in an unprecedented way over our state. We really were very fortunate. We had inconveniences of power loss for less than a week. Georgia Power and CalPMC did a phenomenal job with additional resources they were able to bring in and get that restored as soon as absolutely possible based on the number of downed trees and tackled power lines and issues that we had. We never lost water, as many of the communities did. Citizens were without water. We've seen the consequences of that in Florida and even on the coast of Georgia, where it's pretty catastrophic to be without drinking water for a week or more. And so the main issue we've had is the leftovers of the yard debris and the time that it's taken. And I'll try to keep you informed and report to you that we made progress. So we're still not, I told you the day after the storm that it would take 30 days to make it through the city. Mr. Hardy said 45. And I was really pushing to try to get it done in 30. I still think we're going to meet that timeline. But it's been a challenge. Through 3 weeks, our folks have picked up 2.5 million pounds of yard debris. And so what we did is we started exactly where we stopped before the storm. So we started the day after the storm, where we ended the day before the storm. And following the route system, the daily route system, that's what they've done. And we are now on a Thursday's route. And they hope to start Friday's route this weekend. If not, it's going to be Monday. It will be on Friday's route. So by the middle to the end of next week, we will have completed Friday's route. So what's normally a one-day route is taking a week or more just because of the volume of yard debris and the fact that most piles are claw piles. We were finally able to get some assistance. So right after the storm, the state of Georgia initially said they were going to look at hiring one contractor to pick up yard debris over the entire state as an emergency. They recognized the mammoth problem. After a couple of days, they chose not to do that. Then the county had a contractor they brought in to try and get a county contract to pick up yard debris for all our municipalities and county. That did not materialize. We reached out to the private sector. No one had any resources. So those we've used in the past, like Advanced Disposal, all the resources were deployed to Florida, Texas, or other locations, and there was no excess capacity. So we've had to do this with the existing personnel we've had. And we've taxed them really hard. They work 12-hour days, 7-day weeks. We've deployed everything we've had. We've done relay. Bringing sway car trailers to load and transport, so the claws aren't stopping to go to the landfill and dump. We've done everything we have with the resources that we have. But with that said, we know patience wears thin. And we are here now at the last day. We have a full cycle through the city. I just ask for your patience to get us through next week, and then we should be back on the normal schedule again. So I just want you to know we're doing everything we can. I was in a meeting yesterday, GMA Mel Cody, Council Woman Tilly, Mr. Payton, the mayor, that's everyone's there. A lot of cities, there are probably 50 or 60 city officials from our district. I made a point of talking to elected officials, appointed officials about what they were experiencing. Most of them said it's going to take them 2 months to get through their city. And as last night, I had to leave there and run to a meeting in Savannah, so I had to go back way. I learned a lot about Georgia, trying to get from Florida to Savannah, but I went through cities like Folsom and Kingston and saw the damage they have and the volumes they still have, which is far worse than what we have. And a couple of my city manager friends last night were telling me, north of us, Tiffin, Griffin, 2 months to make it through their city based on the volumes they're experiencing. So I say all that not to minimize the fact that there's been an inconvenience. It's going to take us 30 full days to get through the city. We just continue to ask for patience as we finish it up and get back on track and just know we're using all the resources we have. Yesterday morning, Advanced Disposal did finally have an access truck that they can bring in. It's a huge, I say 80 cubic yard truck. They started yesterday morning, they're working 12-hour shifts, so we think that's really going to help us. We're putting them on the major thoroughfares that we had left till the end, just trying to get the neighborhoods picked up first on the daily route schedule. So you'll see the largest truck I've ever seen in my life is from the city now, trying to help us get through this very end of this process. So again, ask for your patience. We're approaching 3 million tons of yard debris. It's unprecedented storm event, unprecedented amount of volume, and we're doing everything we can with the resources that we have. The last thing, Mayor, just being here tonight in the police program and sort of going back in history, and I guess there's two people here that have a connection to this more so than anybody else. And Councilman Vickers was on the council that hired me in June of 1995 and gave me an opportunity. And Bonus B. Williams was on that council too, and seeing how I'm here tonight just reminds me of that opportunity that we were given. And those were some tough times, and one of the first things was to fix the police department. And one of the proudest moments of my life was in 1999 when our department became accredited. None of that ever would have happened without the support and the trust and the belief of the members of the mayor and council and providing the resources that we needed to build that department up. And to see this continue to get better under Chief Childress's leadership. And now we've met not only every mandatory standard, but every voluntary standard, 100% of the standards, the highest level of accreditation. And I'm proud to have been there all 7 times when our police department received that. I'm representing you. And I always want to make sure that we thank you all. Your leadership, your commitment to invest in the police department is what's allowed these things to happen. And I just want to say